Hello everybody, welcome to my channel Dare to Study. Here it's a new video and this is part 4 of chapter conventional sources of energy. In this video we are going to deal with hydel power plants. So let's get started. It's the fourth and last one, that is hydel power plants or hydel power simply. Now you may ask, hydroelectricity or production of energy from water is a renewable source of energy, but why we are reading it under conventional source of energy, isn't it? Because the word conventional means traditional, okay? It is a traditional source of energy, and hydel power plant has been existing in India since long. Therefore, we are reading it under hydel power plants, okay? So what is the mechanism or what is hydel power plant? Hydroelectricity is the electricity that is generated from water, okay? Now how does it work? What happens to get energy or to produce electricity from this water? We construct various barrages or dams. If suppose the river is flowing and we constructed, and here we have constructed a dam, okay? Now what happens, as we have constructed a dam, it acts as a barrage. Now the water cannot move ahead. Now here we have a gate, okay? Here gate is there, and what happens, once we open this gate, once this gate is opened, now the water can flow from this area easily, okay? So first of all, to generate hydroelectricity, we construct a barrage, or most accurately a dam, so that the water cannot flow. Now here there is a barrage. Now when we open the gate, here we have, suppose it's the route of water, that is when we open the gate, the water will flow like this. Now, and it will flow and go out, that is in its original way. Now here we have a generator, okay? Here we have generator. Now what happens, when we just open the gate, then the water with its full force, as we have stopped it here, then it therefore it has high potential energy, isn't it? And due to its high levels, the potential energy is increasing, or it's much high. Now once we open this gate with its full potential energy, the potential energy then changes into kinetic energy, and with its full energy it just gushes from here, that is through this path it just gushes, and here the turbine which is located, it just rotates the turbine. Because it has much energy, the high amount of potential energy which it had just after opening the gate, it causes motion, and now it is converted to kinetic energy. So this kinetic energy has much force which it used to rotate this turbine which is located here. Now as a result of which, what happens, the electricity or generator works, and thus electricity is produced. Thus in this way hydroelectricity is generated. Now that is, water when comes from a high area to a low area, then it has much energy, so much hydroelectric power or hydroelectricity can be generated, okay? So it was about how it works, and or we can say how is it done. Now here you can notice that no water is utilized, that is the water from the dams or rivers are not taken up, they are just used to rotate it. Therefore we are not wasting water also in producing electricity, isn't it? It's Now by constructing dams, there are other advantages also. So it's a multi-purpose project. It comes as a multi-purpose project. Okay. Now let's move on. Now what I mean by multi-purpose project? See, here the first function that it does is that produce electricity, that is hydroelectricity more accurately. First it produces electricity. Second one, these dams also act or also control floods. That is, if rainfall occurs much heavily and the water, river water is overflowing, then if a dam is there, then it can prevent the water from going to villages or the nearby areas and destructing the area. So it also prevents or control floods, not prevents, it control floods. Now the third one is that irrigation. How irrigation? See, from these dams only many channels in the form of canals, dikes and canals are created, from which water is distributed to the whole nearby area so that irrigation facilities or irrigation can be done properly in that area and vegetation will be high or agricultural output will be high. So I said that it is a multi-purpose project because here we are getting electricity also, it is also controlling floods and it's also helping in irrigation and it's also helps in navigation, etc. and etc. So many things can be done by this project, that is multi-purpose project. Now let's move on to the advantages and disadvantages of hydel power. I hope that you all understood it. That's the mechanism of hydroelectricity. Okay. You will also read it in physics also, isn't it? Because here conversion of energy takes place. So it also comes under physics. Now we are going to discuss what are the advantages and disadvantages of hydel power. The first advantage of hydel power is that it is clean, isn't it? As compared to any other conventional source of energy, hydel power, you can say it's the cleanest, isn't it? So it's a clean and therefore a non-polluting source of energy. It's a non-polluting source of energy. Now what's the second one? As it is non-polluting because no harmful gases, nothing is released from it, only just electricity is produced by rotating the turbine. So it's a clean and non-polluting source of energy. The second one is that by using this hydroelectricity, no greenhouse gases are emitted or no greenhouse gases are released. Therefore, no global warming occurs from this energy. Third one, in the beginning itself I said that hydel power is a renewable source of energy. Okay, so the third advantage is obviously it's a renewable source of energy. Renewable source. And what else? See, dams which are built for this purpose, that is for producing hydroelectricity, also serves as a reservoir of water and it also prevents floods. Also it is helpful in irrigation purposes. Therefore, the dams that are built save water. Dams built the dams that are built for this purpose is also useful to us because it saves water, restores water, so that it can be used later period of time, and it also prevents flood. It can be also used for irrigation purposes and so on and so on. Now let's come to the disadvantage of it. See, to get hydroelectricity, we have to make dams or build dams. Now the construction of dams is costly, or the cost of construction of dams is high. That's the disadvantage. Cost is high for the construction of dams. Okay, now what's the second one? It causes geological damage. How? By the construction of dams, there are many chances that some geological damage like earthquake may occur. Okay. Geological damage. Now, what else? See, if we have to construct a dam, then the places that are living nearby, then the people that are living nearby that place have to be shifted from that place to another. And this shifting may cause some disturbance in the daily activities of the people. It may also have some disturbance in their mind, feelings, etc., isn't it? Because they have been living in that place from a long time. So it causes a disturbance in the lives of people who are displaced. Because we can't allow them to reside in that place itself, because it's dangerous, and moreover we have to construct dams in that place. And even if they are not residing in the place where the dams are going to be constructed, and if they are residing around that place also, then also it's dangerous for them, risky. Therefore the government is bound to shift them, isn't it? So that one is also a disadvantage. Okay. So here we complete the advantages and disadvantages of hydel power. Now we are going to discuss two major hydel power projects. The first one is the Bhakra Nangal Dam. Okay. First is Bhakra. After discussing it, we will move on to Hirakud Dam project. The first one is the Bhakra Nangal Dam. See, it provides water, or the people living in Punjab, Haryana and Rajasthan experience the benefits from this project or from this dam. You can also say that in the states of Punjab and Haryana, this dam is located, that is Bhakra Nangal Dam. This project actually has two dams, okay. One at Bhakra and the other one is at Nangal. Therefore, we collectively say it as the Bhakra Nangal Dam. So, this project actually, what are its components, we can say, okay. First one are the two dams. One at Bhakra and the other at Nangal. Second one is the Nangal hydel plant. Third one is the four power houses. And what's the fourth one? It is the Bhakra canal system. Okay. So you can say these are the four components of the Bhakra Nangal Dam. First one is the two dams, one at Bhakra and the other one at Nangal. Second, Nangal Hydel plant. Third, the four powerhouses, and it means the place where this electricity is produced. And the fifth one, the Bhakra canal system. We will discuss about each one by one. First, about the two dams. That is, first the Bhakra dam. It's present in Punjab. Okay, the Bhakra dam, actually it's present in the border of Punjab and Himachal Pradesh. Okay, now it's built, here I'm gonna write Bhakra dam. It is built in the border of Punjab and Himachal Pradesh. Punjab and Himachal Pradesh. Okay. Now, do you know over which or across which river is this Bhakra dam built? It is built across Satluj River. You all know it, it's flowing in the northwestern part of India, isn't it? So, this Bhakra dam is built across the Satluj River. Now, it's a 90 kilometer long reservoir. Okay, that is reservoir means a place, the place where it is reserved or where we are storing it, the water. It's the dam is 90 kilometer long, and in that place water is stored. And this 90 kilometer long reservoir is also known as, it has one more name, and that is Gobind Sagar. It's also known by the name Gobind Sagar. And it can store 9.3, it is, its capacity is 9.3 million meter cube of water. Isn't it huge? Or you can say a much amount of water. 9.3 million meter cube. So the water holding capacity of Bhakra dam is 9.3 million meter cube. Okay, so first one we covered, here we have two dams. Of that we have already discussed about Bhakra dam. The next we are going to discuss about Nangal dam. Okay, Nangal dam is also built across the Satluj River. That is, both Bhakra dam, so we can understand that both Bhakra dam and Nangal dam are built across the river Satluj. Okay, now this one, Nangal dam, is 64 kilometer long, whereas it was, Bhakra dam was 90 kilometer long, and here Nangal dam is 64 kilometer long and 64 kilometer long and 44 meter deep in depth. Okay, so let's discuss it once again. Bhakra dam across the river Satluj, Nangal dam also across river Satluj. It's 90 kilometer long, 64 kilometer long. It's also known as Gobind Sagar, and it is 44 meter deep. So here we complete the two dams. Now, what is the Nangal Hydel plant? So, now we are going to discuss the four powerhouses. There are four powerhouses in which the power or the electricity is generated from the Bhakra Nangal dam project. Okay, now where are they located? The four powerhouses are located at, first one is at Gangwal, second one Kotla, third one left bank power system and the fourth one is the right bank power system. Okay, so these are the four powerhouses. One is at Gangwal, second one Kotla, third one left bank power system, and the fourth one is right bank power system. And they can generate 1204 milliwatt electricity. Okay, so it was the four power houses. Now the last one is the Bhakra canal system. As I while I was discussing about canals in water resources, I said that they are used for irrigation. So this Bhakra canal system is also used for irrigation. From this project, or you can say from this canal, many areas are irrigated. Around 27.41 lakh hectares of land is irrigated from this Bhakra canal system. And in which regions, or you can ask in which states? In the states of Punjab, Haryana and Rajasthan. These three, comprising these three states, 27.41 lakh hectares receive the supply of water for irrigation from the Bhakra canal system. Okay. Now, what are the aims of this project? If they have done a project and that too such a huge big project, then there must be some aims, isn't it? So we are going to discuss about those. This Bhakra Nangal Dam is also a multi-purpose project. It means that behind making this dam, there are many aims and visions of the people. So we are going to learn about them now. Aim is irrigation. Okay. So, how irrigation or by irrigation? Because by constructing dams, they're providing a check to the flow of rivers. That means that water is collected. From there, by means of canals, water will be provided to the whole regions of Punjab, Haryana and Rajasthan for irrigation. So the first aim of the Bhakra Nangal Dam is irrigation. What's the second one? That is hydroelectricity. That is to generate hydroelectricity. By constructing dams, we generate hydroelectricity, that is we generate electricity from water. So that was also, that is the second aim of the Bhakra Nangal Dam, producing hydroelectricity, which is the cheapest and cleanest source of energy, and it's a non-renewable source of energy too. Therefore, to produce hydroelectricity is the second aim. What's the third one? Third is preventing flood. Preventing flood from which rivers? Satluj and Bees River. Okay. Satluj and Bees rivers. To prevent flood from the Satluj and Bees rivers. So how does it work? See what happens. Bhakra is located at a greater height than the Nangal Dam. So when the door is open, or you can say when the gate of the dam is open, the water just flows, and it is then controlled by the Nangal Dam. And then what happens, the turbine moves and the hydroelectricity is generated. So the second function is done, hydroelectricity production. Then from here, from the Bhakra canal system. By means of the Bhakra canal system, the water is distributed to the whole areas of Punjab, Haryana and Rajasthan for irrigation. And when high amount of rainfall occurs and there is a chance of flood, this Bhakra Nangal dam comes into action. Okay, so it was all about this. Now do you know how many generators are there in the Nangal dam, Bhakra Nangal dam? It comprises of 10 generators. It comprises of 10 generators in all. Now this power generated, that is the electricity that is generated from the Bhakra Nangal dam, that is the hydroelectricity, which all states experiences or which all state gets it, the power that is generated is distributed among the states of Punjab, Haryana, Rajasthan. Okay, let me write it between the among the states. You can say among the states of Punjab, Haryana, Rajasthan, Himachal Pradesh, Chandigarh and Delhi. So these all places are benefited from this project because they get the electricity which is generated here. Punjab, Haryana, Rajasthan, Himachal Pradesh, Chandigarh and Delhi. So here we discuss all about Bhakra Nangal dam. The second one we are going to discuss about Hirakud dam. Okay. So here I think that you may all have understood what is a multi-purpose project. Why is it named so, or why we are speaking that, or why we are saying that it's a multi-purpose project? Because it is serving various purposes. One dam and many purpose, isn't it? Therefore it's called as a multi-purpose project. Similarly, Hirakud dam is also a multi-purpose project. We will learn it, or we will see it how or why we are saying it as a multi-purpose project. Second one is the Hirakud dam. It is constructed or built across the Mahanadi river. Okay, Hirakud dam is in Odisha. It is constructed across Mahanadi river. It is one of the first major dam constructed in India after independence. Okay, it's a very important characteristic of Hirakud dam. It's one of the major dams constructed after independence. Not only dam, it's a multi-purpose river project, isn't it? So is the one of the first one, and it was completed in 1953. That is, the construction of the Hirakud dam was completed in 1953, and it was formally inaugurated by the first Prime Minister of India, Jawaharlal Nehru, on January 3, on 3rd January in the year 1957. So the work was completed in the year 1953, and it was formally inaugurated by the first Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru on January 3, 1957. Okay, now although it's not in the actually I want to tell something else about it. See, while construction of the Hirakud dam, people got much diamonds from this area where it was, when the construction works were done. And it's also said that millions or many people died while making this project. So these are two things that I knew about Hirakud Dam, though it's not in the syllabus, I just said it. Okay, now moving further, what else? Okay, it's the longest earthen dam in Asia, a crown further to the cap of Hirakud Dam, and that is longest earthen dam. Longest earthen dam in Asia. Okay, it's the longest major earthen dam in Asia. So what else we can tell about Hirakud Dam? What is its water storing capacity? Okay, the water storing capacity is 743 kilometer. I'm going to tell the length of the shore, coastline shore. The length of the Hirakud Dam coastline shore is 639 kilometer. It has several dikes also around it. That is, with this dam there are several dikes, and the coastline shore is, the length of the coastline shore is 639 kilometer. Now you can say it is a shoreline also, shoreline of 639 kilometer. Now there are two observation towers, okay, around the Hirakud Dam there are two observation towers. One is at Hirakud and the other is at Burla. The Nehru Minar is in Hirakud, whereas the Gandhi Minar is in Burla. Okay, so it supports, that is, it supports two hydel power plants. So I mean to say that water from this Hirakud Dam is used for making electricity in two hydel power plants. One is in Burla and the other one is in Chiplima. So in these two places, water from the Hirakud Dam is used to make electricity, that is hydroelectric city. The capacity of the powerhouse is 307.5 megawatt. The capacity of the powerhouse is 307.5 megawatt. Now, as I have said in the beginning, that it's a multi-purpose project, isn't it? So what are its multi-purposes? First of all, production of hydroelectricity. Second one, irrigation. It provides water for irrigation around, in a vast area, that is in the districts of Sambalpur, Bargarh, Subarnapur and Balangir. These four districts gets water from the Hirakud Dam for irrigation. What are they? Sambalpur, Bargarh, Balangir and Subarnapur. Okay, so these four districts gets water for irrigation from this single project, that is the Hirakud Dam. Now it also controls the flood, or it also helps in protection of the area, protection of people from flood. That is, mainly Cuttack and Puri experience this advantage, that is they get protected from flood by this Hirakud Dam project, Cuttack and Puri. Okay, so this was all about the Hirakud Dam. Once again, let's revise it. It's built across the Mahanadi River, and the construction was completed in the year 1953, and Jawaharlal Nehru formally inaugurated this dam on January 3, 1957. It's the longest earthen dam in Asia. The shoreline is 639 kilometer long, and two hydel power. It supports two hydel power, one at Burla and the other at Chiplima. The powerhouses have a capacity of 307.5 megawatt, and there are two watt. It also provides irrigation to the districts of Sambalpur, Bargad, Balangir and Subarnapur. There are two observation towers, the Gandhi Minar at Burla and the Nehru Minar at Hirakud. And what else? And it also save the places of Cuttack and Puri from flood. So it was all about Hirakud. Here we complete the chapter conventional sources of energy. In this video we discussed about hydel power plant. In part 1 I discussed about coal. In part 2 I completed petroleum. In part 3 I discussed about natural gas, and this is part 4 in which I discuss about hydel power plant. There will be one more video on this chapter, that is conventional sources of energy, in which I am going to discuss some past year's questions. Thank you for watching till the end, and you can see all the videos of Door to Study in my playlist, that is ICSE Geography Class 10. Thank you for watching till the end. Bye bye.